Welcome to There's Sometimes a Buggy, Irresponsible Opinions about Classic Film. I'm Elise.
I'm Dave. This week we return to the Jean Arthur Acteurist Oeuvre-view with a pair of films that she made in 1940, Too Many Husbands and Arizona. Both films made with the director-writer team, Wesley Ruggles and Claude Binyon. We've met them before on the podcast. They had taken up residence at Paramount in the late 1930s.
Did we see anything of theirs other than True Confessions?
I don't think so for the podcast, but we have seen The Gilded Lily. We've seen Sing You Sinners. I met him in Paris. That's another one where two men and one woman are in the mix. This is post-Capra. That's an important thing to note before we even get going. Capra left Columbia after Mr. Smith Goes to Washington, and it seems like Jean Arthur has found her new collaborator in Wesley Ruggles, and we'll have to see how they did in these two disparate films, the first of which is a farce or screwball comedy, the second of which is an epic western. Let's hear from Leonard Maltin before we get into the films. Too Many Husbands. He gives it 3 stars out of 4. Jean is married to Douglas when husband number one, McMurray, thought dead, turns up. Excellent comedy from W. Somerset Maugham's play, Home and Beauty. And it was remade as 3 for the show. The cast list, Jean Arthur, Fred McMurray, Melvin Douglas, Harry Davenport, Dorothy Peterson, Edgar Buchanan, director Wesley Ruggles.
So what we can say as an overview of both movies, I don't know if you'll agree with this, Dave, is that the Too Many Husbands farce was definitely more radical in its take on sexual mores and even on gender roles than Arizona ended up being.
I mean, Arizona, as we'll discuss, it does pose some interesting questions about what you can do with a female character in a Western, but ultimately it does wind up getting backed into a more conventional corner.
Well, the whole movie is the process of normalizing the female character,
yeah,
so it's
exactly
extremely conventional.
Too Many Husbands, on the other hand,
doesn't normalize anything.
No, the reverse. Jean Arthur is in revolt against all conventions in this film. Very interesting that this is the one where she really looks the most like a movie star. They've really done her up.
You think of every movie she's made up to this point, you think this one?
I would say so.
I don't know if it was just the contrast of Arizona where her looks are very much downplayed and she's allowed to look like she's 40, but yeah, she did seem notably glamorous and gorgeous in Too Many Husbands, and she'd better because she has to keep two men on a string for the entirety of the movie. Although she
does
a pretty good job of keeping William Holden on a string in Arizona anyway. So I found this bit of information in TCM site's notes on the film. It says here, the PCA, or Production Code Authority, informed Columbia in October 1939, so several months before the movie appeared, that the script of the play was in violation of the production code because of its apparent lack of any respect for the sanctity of marriage, its farcical treatment of the subject of bigamy, and its very frank and detailed discussion of the unsavory subject of divorce by collusion. So, of all of those issues, the only one that's clearly been resolved in the final screenplay is the divorce by collusion.
No one conspires with anyone else to end a marriage. It's all ended by judicial fiat at the end of the film.
I don't know if the nosing around of the police officers or the patriarchal interference of the father were enough to placate the production code. Of course, it ends up just making everything seem smuttier. What the production code is there for, to make everything seem smuttier.
So that it can be condemned.
This movie has some points of comparison to the more familiar and popular My Favorite Wife that came out the same year.
And we'll be discussing that one in depth for our Valentine's 2023 episode, just a few months away.
How closely do you think these movies compare, though, Dave?
Other than the plot involving the threat of bigamy, there's really not much else that winds up being the same, because My Favorite Wife is all about concealment, and it's about Cary Grant being frazzled trying to navigate this difficult situation. Too Many Husbands is about Jean Arthur reveling in the situation.
And also reflective of that is the relatively equal star power of Melvin Douglas and Fred McMurray.
Yes, both borrowed.
Who are nevertheless convincingly subordinate to Jean Arthur throughout this movie.
Yeah, and these are both male stars who have shown themselves to be very easygoing about that kind of thing. As far as I know, they were actually happy to support a major female star. We see Melvin Douglas doing this a lot at MGM and at Paramount occasionally, and McMurray certainly throughout his Paramount career was doing that nonstop. Both of these guys had worked with Binyon and Ruggles at Paramount, because Melvin Douglas was in I Met Him in Paris, and McMurray was in several Wesley Ruggles films at Paramount. So good relationships already pre-established. You have to think that was part of their agreement to be in it, because the script really makes them both look like idiots, and yeah, they just are happy to go along with it.
They're just playing absolute idiots through the whole movie. Yeah, seemingly with the greatest of joy. To give you some idea of how comparatively equal they were considered in star power, says here again in the TCM notes, a February 1940 Hollywood Reporter news item indicated that Columbia selected a jury of 12 female college students from UCLA to help it decide which of two possible endings it should use for the film. A subsequent news item noted that all of the film except for the ending would be screened for co-eds from UCLA and USC, and that they would discuss the ending with studio officials. The director had one ending in which Jean Arthur takes Fred McMurray as her husband, and another in which she takes Melvin Douglas. The studio also reportedly sent out more than 10,000 questionnaires to college students throughout the country to help it decide which ending to use. So the people voted, or the college students voted, for Fred McMurray. And he is portrayed as the slightly sexier husband. But the ending doesn't really resolve anything.
No, it totally undercuts all of that. She's going to keep both of them in perpetuity, it would seem.
Of note here, this seems to be a strategy of Ruggles and Binyon in other movies that we've watched, other comedies that we've watched of theirs. The roughly equally matched male suitors. He's worked with Melvin Douglas before in I Met Him in Paris at Paramount, with Fred McMurray in The Gilded Lily.
In several films, but yeah, notably in this case, The Gilded Lily.
Who was the actress in that one?
Claude Colbert.
Is Colbert also?
Mm-hmm.
Right, because I remember when we watched that one together, we commented that what was interesting about it as one of those movies where the woman has to pick between two suitors is that it was difficult to know which one she ought to pick until at the very end, one of the suitors gets thrown under the bus by the script.
Yeah, we won't reveal which one, because we're going to do that film on the podcast probably 10 years from now.
So that was Fred McMurray and
Ray Milland.
Yeah, and they were both very young and sexy in that movie. So hard to know who she should choose. Watch it for yourself and decide for yourself.
And I Met Him in Paris is fairly similar. It's Robert Young and Melvin Douglas.
Finally, with this play and this script, Ruggles and Binyon do not have to have their heroine choose.
Not really, no. That's the whole point of it. And again, you got a brief fake out at the beginning when she finds out. She does a few sort of Cary Grant style double takes along with her dad and Melvin Douglas, who faints. Everyone's thinking about, oh my god, this is an incredibly difficult situation. This is the kind of thing that creates a farce plot in my life. I don't want a farce plot to take over my life. But then she realizes, yes, I do.
But before that, we have a very interesting way that we get some exposition, some insight into what's going on in Jean Arthur's mind before this dilemma presents itself.
So we find out that both marriages have their disappointing sides. And we find all of that out through a genius
well, let's call it insane expositional strategy.
Oh, I love it. I think it's brilliant.
The normal way to do this scene would maybe have the secretary say, I'm getting married, and then, I don't know, maybe Jean Arthur could just confess all of this that's on her mind to her.
No.
But that's not how it goes.
Dorothy Peterson, one of my very favorite supporting actresses, having a blast in this film. This may be her most memorable role.
And now both of these movies are good examples of something I've been talking about again a lot lately in the episodes, which is the Hollywood movie standard of one female character, one important female character, and no other female characters in a million men, particularly Arizona.
Well, yeah.
Where she's the only white woman in the town and in the movie, and there's only one other speaking role for a woman.
Yeah.
In this one, there's also, if I recall correctly, only one other speaking role for a woman, maybe only one other woman we even see. And this is it, but it's memorable.
It absolutely is. We find out that Dorothy Peterson, she's giving up now. She's marrying a man she doesn't love. You want to know why? It's because I've only loved two men in my life and you took both of them. And she says, you know, what chance do I have to compete with you? Jean Arthur's like, oh, well, don't be ridiculous. But Dorothy Peterson pulls ahead with this psychodrama that she has been invested in for years, it seems. So she projected herself into the marriage of Jean Arthur with Fred McMurray.
And very successfully, because as she's telling this story, Jean Arthur gets really caught up in this as though they are the same person.
We were so disappointed when it turns out that Fred McMurray couldn't stick around the office or even at home. He has to disappear to parts unknown on adventures around the world. And of course, leaving his wife behind. This is how he got himself into this predicament, presumed lost at sea for a year. The honeymoon was wonderful, but it evaporated quickly into this endless safari. She turns to husband number two, Melvin Douglas. He loves her. We see little examples throughout the early bits of the film that he is obsessed with his wife, doesn't want to deal with this challenge of the dead husband, wants to eradicate his memory if he can. Unfortunately, he hasn't been all that present in the marriage either, and the secretary sees that because he's so caught up in business affairs with his publishing company.
So I guess these are two typical complaints a wife could have.
Absolutely.
About her husband.
In 1940, these would be the two poles of poor husbandry.
Going off on adventures and
never coming home from work.
Yeah, there you go.
That's the last time we see Dorothy Peterson, right? She's not involved in any of the rest of the film, but she goes out in a blaze of glory.
She's been absorbed inside the mind of Jean Arthur. I don't know. The other thing of note is the farcical acting style that Wesley Ruggles encourages his actors to adopt here, which is somewhat undercut or lent some further dimension by his interest in Jean Arthur's erotic face journeys throughout the film.
Mm-hmm.
She's really, really getting a lot of sexual pleasure out of this situation.
Yeah.
It's kind of obscene.
It's incredible, and she's really playing it up, and the camera is there to capture it. It's there for it.
It's really slipping some things past the code there.
The idea here is that Jean Arthur has not gotten what she wanted out of her marriages, either of them, and now that both men are back in play, she is going to take advantage of the situation to force them to focus on her exclusively.
And one of the things you keep expecting from the plot, or I did anyway, was that at some point there's going to be some kind of variation, at least, where the men will rebel against this, right? Who will come up with something between themselves.
Well, they try, right? They go away for a night.
Yeah, but even that is just to get her to pay more attention to them.
No, they never get any kind of a revenge on her.
Or in any way break out from this competition. Although they get friendlier about it. They start to realize that they're just permanently in this situation.
Never get out of it, because the last scene shows that this is going to be...
It's going to be the rest of their lives. The only thing that's of more interest, and they are best friends, so that is important to this narrative too. The only thing that's of more interest to them than their interests that were taking them away from their wife is competing with each other.
Well, there is that. There is that. Although I think the movie makes less of that than it would have if it was a different kind of film, because it still wants you to think more about Jean Arthur and what she's doing.
Well, competing with each other specifically for her.
In another context, you might get a movie where it seems like the prize is irrelevant. And that's not how this movie plays it, right?
Sure.
Because we've seen movies where it's really all about two men competing, maybe for the same woman, but the woman is not important. That's not what they're doing in this movie.
But there has to be some reason that there's enough of an attraction for them to stay in this situation rather than give in to their usual distraction.
Well, yeah, it's because Jean Arthur is saying, you can't take me for granted. I'm not just your wife right now. I am someone to be courted continuously.
I was gonna say, yeah, I guess it's because they're being kept in the wooing state.
And she likes it.
We should talk a bit about the bizarre role that her father assumes at the beginning of this story. He's like the voice of superego or patriarchal authority who keeps telling her that she can't continue to enjoy this, to experience the jouissance of this situation. She has to choose between them. And also he's going to carefully guard the situation. Basically, right from the very beginning, and this is the farce aspect, you are meant to be thinking constantly about the probability of her having sex with both men.
Yeah, and I think it's actually very canny of the film, and, you know, by design, they cast Harry Davenport in this role, who is the least authoritarian patriarch figure you're ever going to see, right?
Right.
Almost always, he plays the indulgent grandpa, or we just saw him in You Can't Take It With You as the judge who lets things develop, you know, in a more freewheeling way in his court. And that's what happens here. So even though, yeah, he's making noises like a patriarch, he's not able to enforce anything.
Definitely not.
And he's not even really trying. He just feels like he has to make these speeches. Again, that just goes with the flow of the film, which is that Jean Arthur is going to get her way in everything in this situation.
And oddly enough, not only are we constantly thinking about that, but the men form a homosexual couple almost immediately in the film as well. Not one that we're supposed to take seriously. There's a lot of joking about it. That's the only way that you can imply a homosexual relationship at this time in a film, or one of the few ways in which you can do it. We're getting some kind of more comedic but definite implications of something more like a threesome.
Trying to get viewers to think back to something like Design for a Living.
Right. I can't remember that film very well. Is there some flirtation between the male characters?
Well, yeah, that's an explicit threesome story, right? It's the Noel Coward.
Well, it can't be that explicit.
The play is, I think.
Really?
But no, not the movie. The movie gets it across, I think. It's the Lubitsch one, right?
I'm not even sure if Noel Coward was allowed to be completely explicit on the stage about that sort of thing, but...
Okay, maybe not completely explicit, but as explicit as he needed to be for sophisticated theater-goers to know what he's talking about.
Right. Now, here, this is treated, like, much, much less seriously, but still, it's there. It's in the mix of the subtext, or the text, actually. So, basically, we're to think all sorts of possible naughty things going on between everybody.
On the screen, the men are exiled to their own guest bedroom, which is all furnished with, you know, the latest frilly things.
Jean Arthur gets a double bed because no one actually sleeps with her in it, but they are exiled to a room with Bert and Ernie twin beds.
Yeah, but that double bed, obviously, as you say, because no one's actually going to make it into that bed, they can leave it that way, and it's there as the goal line.
Yeah.
And where the men want to get to and never quite do in the film.
And there's even those shots of her waiting for them to fight over her and someone to come to bed. And she's sitting in one chair, lounging around, looking sexy. Then she tries another one. Then she looks at the bed and thinks about lying on that and says, oh no, I better not do that, and goes back to the first chair.
But even before that, on her way up to her bedroom, she goes up the stairs in an extremely provocative way.
That's true, yeah.
Jean Arthur, we've talked a lot about how we don't necessarily associate her with extreme eroticism in the 30s, although she will be a major participant in a scene that people often cite as the most erotic kissing scene of the 40s.
We'll have to see how we think that fits into her persona when we rewatch that. Here, I mean, I guess what I'd say is when she's telling Howard Hawks that she doesn't do that sort of thing, what she means is acting in a way to turn men on.
Yeah, she's turned on all by herself.
Yeah, well, not all by herself. She's turned on by the men.
Yeah, but it's for her.
Yeah.
It's not for them.
Yeah.
It's not for Howard Hawks.
No, but of course that can be very sexy, seeing anyone, male or female. That's why I think Jimmy Stewart's so sexy. Seeing anyone's erotic arousal on screen can be a very sexy experience for the viewer.
Deriving gratification from thinking about the way she's driving these guys crazy is wonderful. There's no plot other than that, it's just a lot of going around in circles and these guys fighting, trying to get her to choose. She doesn't want to. She explains that she might need to spend time with them separately, but that doesn't really work either because each person has a different claim on her. She winds up saying that she wants to be with both of them.
Well, beyond the idea of having the two men paying attention to her because neither one was doing that before, the more radical implication of the film is, of course, not any kind of bigamy situation, it's polyamory, and the idea that she's in love with both men, yeah, and simply wants to continue to have both men in her life.
And we do see, because they get their separate scenes, we see vastly different relationships between them, right? With Fred McMurray, it's a more standard kind of erotic charge between them. And with Melvin Douglas, she gets upset at him for giving up and gives him this speech about how he has to fight and be a man about it. And she gets really into it, talks him into it, and talks herself into wanting him.
Yeah, she has two different kinds of relationships with them,
yeah,
that seem to be of equal importance to her. There's also the hilarious, ridiculous scene where Fred McMurray just starts showing off in the most...
leaping over chairs.
The most ridiculous, basic, but not, you know, that's not... it's psychologically accurate male way.
Yeah, yeah. Melvin Douglas tries to follow suit and falls immediately on his face. But even Fred McMurray later goes too far.
He's showing off his athleticism by leaping over furniture in the living room.
Yeah, and he picks a chair that's a little bit too high, or he gets a little distracted after he's complacent because he's been winning so often in this scene, and he falls over too.
But this is what I mean by both of the men, but particularly right from the first time we see him, Fred McMurray, are willing to just act like complete jackasses.
Yeah, yeah, because they're not the drivers of the plot in any way. They are just signifiers in the mind of Jean Arthur. Then we get the police involved.
Well, that's after they decide to punish her for choosing both of them.
So they go out and get drunk and spend the night feeding pigeons. That's a really fun scene, too, right? The birds are just sitting all over them. And that's the extent of their rebellion.
Yeah, and again, they're just happily acting like these passive idiots.
Yeah.
Right? They're both completely content as actors and characters to be in this position.
Yeah. And Jean Arthur wants to go out looking for them. The dad just says, why don't we just go to bed and look in the morgue tomorrow? She calls the police. She wants to put out an APB on them. She gets into trouble by talking about her husbands.
And the police are right on this. They might as well be the production code authority.
Yeah, absolutely. They catch this one little linguistic slip. You're not supposed to have more than one husband. Can't pluralize that.
And we're going to have to come right over to your house and check that out. Do you think in real life in 1940 that the police would be this concerned with possible bigamy?
No, of course not. This is the brain office coming to the house.
Right, or it's just the whole idea of women's sexuality being policed, or everybody's sexuality being policed, but particularly women's.
And it's Edgar Buchanan, and we see him in both films, actually. He's in Arizona as well.
What the police would be very interested in is if they uncovered a homosexual relationship, of course.
Depending on the city or the state, yeah, there could be huge repercussions, and it was technically illegal everywhere in the United States, I believe. He and his partner, Tom Dugan, come over and they start interrogating everyone because the husbands have returned at this point. They almost get away with it because...
even the butler gives the right answer.
Yeah, Melville Cooper. So yeah, great character actors in this film. Melville Cooper, we saw most recently in The Lady Eve. Edgar Buchanan, you probably know best from Henny Serenade. He plays Applejack, their best friend guy.
This is actually a very funny scene with these Lynchian detectives.
Yeah, they really want to get to the bottom of this. They want to catch someone in a slip. 95% of the scene, it goes the way Jean Arthur wants.
That's a pip, the one guy keeps saying.
They catch her right at the end by throwing Mrs. Cadu at her, and she falls for it because she's supposed to be Mrs. Lounge. Can't be both. It's not allowed in our society. So they're hauled into court. I like the way this movie, because a lot of these screwball comedies, including My Favorite Wife, end in a courtroom.
Right, and that is, as I've mentioned before, that's a very ancient conventional comedy structure. Northrop Frye talking about how comedy is basically legalistic in nature.
Yeah. And sometimes it's funny, sometimes it's not. It's often the weakest part of a 30s screwball comedy when they go into court.
Yeah, true.
In My Favorite Wife, I actually really like it. I think Granville Bates is hilarious as the judge.
Well, it's the part where everything's getting resolved, so that, yeah, can be very boring, yes.
But sometimes it works, sometimes it doesn't. But in this movie, they don't even chance it. They just make it all happen off screen.
Yeah, because the college students have already voted.
That's right. She emerges from her audience with the judge and says, sorry, look, I didn't make this choice.
Well, also, but if you showed it, it would give more sort of weight to the decision, whereas it's pretty much arbitrary.
You could just imagine Jean Arthur is lying. But I guess not, because she'd be arrested eventually if she was living with the wrong man, or she'd get into more trouble anyway.
Schrodinger's marriage here.
Yeah. She says the judge has basically annulled the Douglas marriage because she should not have been allowed to leave the first marriage because McMurray wasn't dead.
But that is, of course, the college students chose the dirtier solution because that means that she's been having non-marital sex this entire time.
That's right.
Melvin Douglas.
That's right. We just have to forget about that. She makes it very clear to Melvin Douglas that she wants him to go out to dinner with them that night. She just is going to keep right on going with her three-pronged affair. McMurray is not too impressed with this. He thinks that he's finally won, even if it's a judge that made the decision, whatever.
But he doesn't know, there's nothing he can really do about it.
No. She wants to have a third wheel at the dinner. Well, she can. And she's just living it up as the movie ends. They're dancing. She's like, oh, this is great. And that's how it fades out. There's no other denouement than that.
And they start doing some really idiotic dance moves again.
Well, I guess that's the Lambeth Walk. I'm not sure, though.
They look pretty stupid when they're doing it by themselves.
Yeah. Just going to be an endless round of fun for Jean Arthur. A pretty demeaning existence for these two guys.
And as soon as we're off screen and the production code has nothing to say about it, they'll all start having sex. Not a bad problem.
So Leonard Maltin on Arizona. Lively story of determined woman battling corruption and plundering while trying to settle in new Arizona territory. Well done, but seems to go on forever. It's 127 minutes. He gives it 2.5 stars out of 4. Cast list: Jean Arthur, William Holden, Warren William, Porter Hall, Paul Harvey, directed by Wesley Ruggles. I've actually got some things I can bring in from the John Oler book here. Arthur's performance as the pioneering Phoebe Titus, while charming at times, lacks the conviction she brought to the role of Calamity Jane in The Plainsman. That's probably true, although The Plainsman is a much bigger mess, narratively.
I don't know what that means, lacks conviction.
Well, she really got into that whip scene at the beginning of The Plainsman.
Well, she doesn't... I don't know, she kind of really gets into threatening the guy with a gun in this movie.
I'm not sure I necessarily agree, but that must be where he's going with that. Perhaps this is because she reserved most of her passion for the cast's animals. She adopted a dozen or so stray dogs, several of them lame or blind, and kept them at the private guest ranch she had rented. For another 40 mongrels that were selected from the local pound to appear in the movie, she collected sacks of groceries and hired veterinarians to look them over. Often, late at night, she drove 20 miles from her ranch to the set to assure herself that they were being properly cared for. She had the cast pigs hosed down with kerosene to cure their skin diseases, and when she saw the goats with nothing to eat but cactus, she ordered in tons of bales of hay, which they promptly ignored in favor of the cactus. At the close of filming, Arthur was frantically searching for a way to save the mongrel dogs, who were otherwise destined for the pound's gas chamber. Her solution was to sponsor a show in the lobby of the Santa Rita Hotel, at which the dogs were given away to Tucson's underprivileged children. With each dog given away went a 3-year paid-up license, a new leash and collar, and several months' worth of dog food, all courtesy of Jean Arthur. There's also some stuff in there about how she was really freaked out by having to compete in the beauty sweepstakes with William Holden, who's like 20 years old.
So she didn't just freak out competing with women, but also with men.
Yeah, she met him and apparently just walked out. What the hell is this? He's 20 years younger than me. Well, but apparently they became friends afterwards.
Of course, this is a very rare instance of a new, like a male starlet getting paired with an older generation of actress. Obviously, it worked the other way around much more radically especially in the 1950s and 60s, when these ancient male stars were still hanging around and getting paired with 20-year-old actresses. Much less of a radical age difference here.
This only happened because, again, Columbia had no male stars. This is basically their only one.
Of course, this happens to William Holden a lot, though. He keeps getting paired with older women, usually not in equal romances like this one is.
Like what?
Like Sunset Boulevard?
Oh, okay. Interesting.
And Picnic.
Well, no, he's older in Picnic.
No, I'm talking about Rosalind Russell lust.
Okay, well, sure.
Like I said, not equal romances in those cases.
But he comes to Columbia to star in Golden Boy, which they made in 1939, which is a great movie. And there he's paired with Barbara Stanwyck, who is older than him as well. But that's part of the plot. In this film,
it's never commented on, but it's visually obvious.
Although I think he does a pretty good job. Like, he doesn't really seem like a 20-year-old
No,
in this
that's
movie.
True. But he seems significantly younger than she is.
Like, keep in mind, this is made the exact same year as Our Town, where he plays the teenage guy who's going, aw, shucks.
It's a stage teenager.
Well, yeah, but he actually almost is a teenager. Here he's playing a kind of grizzled veteran of the trails, and he comes across pretty well in that role, I think.
Yeah, but anyway, you can tell he's much younger and prettier than she is in this movie.
Sure.
I don't know, she might win the beauty contest in Too Many Husbands, or at least have a fighting chance.
She was worried about that role, too, just in passing. She didn't think it made any sense for two men to be fighting over her. She thought that was ludicrous because she's not pretty enough.
Why didn't she just stop taking any movie roles? Because she's obviously not pretty enough. Just hang up your spurs, Jean Arthur, and go home.
She obviously considered it many times, as we've discussed in the past.
Melvin Douglas and Fred McMurray, particularly Melvin Douglas, aren't that pretty. Fred McMurray has a certain wonky appeal, but Melvin Douglas is not a handsome man.
And no, that's not what he's primarily known for. He's got his dry wit, which he doesn't really use in Too Many Husbands.
No, he's really got nothing going for him other than this easygoing willingness to play an idiot that he shares with Fred McMurray.
And he would bring that to a Lubitsch film the next year, where he keeps poking Merle Oberon and saying, keeks. That's his main character trait in that movie, driving her to distraction.
Clearly, Melvin Douglas never said, am I pretty enough to be the love interest of Greta Garbo? He didn't ask himself that question.
He didn't worry about these things.
He makes her laugh.
Melvin Douglas is so unattractive and annoying that he drives Merle Oberon, his wife, into the arms of Burgess Meredith. That Lothario. Let's get into Arizona. So this is an epic Western, and Wesley Ruggles would have been very much associated with that genre, if only in the distant past by 1940, because he's the director of Cimarron, which was a giant Oscar winner, which we will be doing at some point in the future.
So this movie cost a lot, and it did lose money for Columbia.
Did it?
Yeah, it lost $500,000, Wikipedia says.
Oh, wow.
Well, the film's budget was $2 million.
Right, that's a lot.
And it went well over that budget, apparently.
So it made a lot of money at the box office, just not enough to recoup that investment.
It was shot in the Sonoran Desert.
On location, so that's where the bills start really adding up.
And that is one of the points of interest of the movie, when we're getting this tour of 1861 Tucson.
Yeah.
It all looks very, very authentic.
I have to ask my pal Gareth about that. I mean, he grew up in Tucson.
In 1861?
No, he's a little younger than that.
So I guess there's two problems with the film. First of all, I should say that often when I'm interested to see how one of these old popular novel source plots differs from the movie version, the place that I go to is Goodreads, and it did not fail me on this occasion. So the author of the novel is someone we've encountered in Jean Arthur land before. Clarence Buddington Bud Kellen. Do you remember who he is, Dave?
Yeah, he wrote the book that Mr. Deeds, or the story that Mr. Deeds was based on.
He was a self-described best second-rate writer in America. He wrote reams and reams of things.
He appears on Information Please, my favorite radio program.
So people on Goodreads have read this novel and have recapped it for us. Indeed, in the novel, apparently she is not gender normalized.
Really?
This was something done just for the movie version.
Okay. So she stays the way she is at the beginning.
Amazonian, yes.
Okay.
Of course, one of the problems I have with the movie is not even just that it spends it starts time progressively normalizing her, but that it shows us so many versions of a more equal relationship early on, and there never seems to be any... It's like the characters keep changing, because there never seems to be any pressure on her to become more feminine. I mean, part of the problem that happens with the plot is she just becomes stupider and more incompetent. It's proposed on many occasions, right from the beginning, he accepts her, he's attracted to her, he...
Serenades her.
Yeah, they're both attracted to each other instantly, and him more instantly. He even goes so far as to say, I'll get used to your britches. He doesn't ask her to change in any way. At several points, it's proposed that, you know, what she needs is help as a person, not particularly as a woman, in this rough life that she's trying to lead, and these dirty business dealings, and problems with the Indians, and all sorts of things. Basically, that they should just become partners. At some points, it's proposed that she's his boss.
Well, she is his boss.
And she does order him around to do some odd things, but nevertheless, the overall story by the end is of her becoming more and more of a damsel in distress and voluntarily giving up these, masculine characteristics.
Though she doesn't give up all of them, right?
She gives up 99% of them.
So much weight is thrown toward that, but you do have to remember, by the end of this film, just like the end of Too Many Husbands, everything is set up exactly the way she wanted it. She is running this ranch, which she owns. He is marrying her, so I guess it doesn't matter anymore who the boss is, but it's all what she wanted, and it's all her dream that he is assisting with. So that is different from what you normally see.
It's not at all what is emphasized.
Yeah, everything else does fall away. She does start wearing more dresses. She does start to seem like her judgment is impaired at various points.
And she can't come up with any good ideas, and she acts like a moron, and...
And the worst thing is that, now, I don't know exactly what this is all about. Maybe Wesley Ruggles, because as we've seen, it's the same person making both movies. There may have been an attempt to show us or make us feel that it's kind of an injustice that it has to go this way, but that's how the society was set up at the time. She wants to fight a duel or shoot it out with Warren William, and he won't, right?
She's actually explicitly given the opportunity to stand up for him herself.
No, she does. She does. And Warren William says, I'm not going to have a gunfight with you. I'm going to have a gunfight with your man when he comes home.
Well, that's not what I got out of the scene at all. What I got out of the scene was that her friend, her partner, gives her an opportunity to say, no, I'm saying that as myself. And she refuses that and says, no, I've got a man to back me up.
Yeah, well, she does say that, right? But he's not going to fight her that way. And she knows that. And I think that's part of the story,
she
too.
She can fight whoever she wants to when she feels like it. She doesn't have to wait for him to agree to fight her.
We do see it several times. I mean, she shoots a lot of people in this movie, and she threatens even more.
Yeah, whatever it's doing with gender, which it's very confused about, it is a very conservative Western. You can't read this in any way as a subversion or a satire, I don't think.
No, I don't think so. I mean, it's the standard civilizing, quote-unquote, Western, where you're looking at the emergence of a viable town out of the chaos of, you know, early colonial settlement, and we're starting to get a sense that they will start building institutions that can last, rather than just having gunfights out in the streets all day long, and the town being run by saloon owners.
The ultimate evil that you can do is
sell guns
to hostile Indians. Only the devil would do that, which is what Warren William is kind of playing, and with no nuance or other notes whatsoever.
No, and Warren William is one of my very favorite actors, but this is kind of a phoned-in performance. I mean, he's getting a little bit of fun out of it, especially with Porter Hall. Their act together is great. You're stupid!
Yeah, it's kind of one repeat.
You idiot!
One repeated note.
Yeah, well, the final note is a gunshot in the back. As Porter Hall, you know, he's so satisfied. Oh, I'm glad we're friends again. I'm so happy. Bang.
There are a ton of dead Indian bodies.
Oh, yeah, it's horrible.
Throughout the film. What else? Oh, also, Jean Arthur's character couldn't give a shit about slavery and says so. She's just an entrepreneur who's trying to do business in an honest way. That's all that can be said for her.
An accurate presentation, I would say, probably, of the settlers in Arizona at the time.
Yeah,
it's an interesting little quirk that Arizona was getting going this way just as the Civil War was being fought, you know, they did pledge allegiance to the Confederate States in hopes that they might get some military backup from them with the Union Army leaving. And yeah, all of that is played as completely value neutral.
She's kind of an unpleasant character. The only way we're even made to root for her is by having Warren William go up against her because he's just slime.
I mean, she at least wants to play by some sort of rules to get ahead and be a champion entrepreneur. She wants to own the most impressive cattle ranch in the territory, right? She wants to be like the family in Giant.
Sure.
So on the face of it, that's not exactly a protagonist, you know, you and I are typically going to get behind. She gets this big idea when she goes in to buy needles and the general store guy has to charge her 25 cents. And that's a great role for Paul Harvey, actually. I really liked him as Saul, general store owner who becomes her partner. He's her friend all the way through. He says, you know, what do you want from me? I have to charge 25 cents because the freight carriers are jacking up the prices on me. And that's where she gets her idea. Well, let's undercut them. Let's have fair rates for freight instead of gouging everybody. Now, we don't really see what kind of business practices she gets involved in. Is she underpaying her own employees? The movie just makes it seem like, no, these criminals are just skimming huge amounts of money off. Presented as unambiguously good, she's gonna bring in things that people can actually buy for reasonable prices. So she's a culture hero in that sense.
And she's a entrepreneurial visionary. She knows who's gonna want stoves in a few years.
That's right. Saul says, I'm gonna have those rusting stoves on my hands forever. And she says, no, you'll see. She wants to parlay that into this giant cattle ranch. Once she gets a hold of this idea of marrying William Holden, her way is clear. She sees that they will run this ranch together and everything's going to be amazing. It almost is, except for the machinations of Warren William, who steals all of her money and then lends it back to her.
The main point of interest here is the progression of this relationship, so I think that is what we need to dig into, I guess.
So it's a very interesting beginning to the relationship because they're all meet cute and spending a bunch of time together, but then he leaves the next day and he says, look, sorry, I've got the wanderlust. I've got to go to California. I've got to see it. And it's better that I do it now instead of in the middle of our relationship like Fred McMurray in Too Many Husbands. And she accepts that, although she's annoyed. And then he does come back as a Union soldier later on. The relationship continues. Basically, as you said, he's not making any demands on her. She's doing it all to herself. She's feminizing herself without any pressure.
But see, the movie goes through so many different phases with this that at first I thought it was being interesting with it. And I guess it initially is. Like in that scene where she's always, I guess, has some hold on femininity.
She's making pies. That's her job at the beginning.
A pie maker. Although she's trying to get out of that and do something that makes more money. And I don't know, I guess this is how she's earned the goodwill of some of the men in the town. They love her pies.
They love her pies.
Because they back her up in that initial scene where she's trying to get some stolen money back in the saloon. And she's like literally the only white woman in town, as they say. So basically the only woman trying to be on equal terms with the men. We learned that she lost her father.
Yeah, they were going to California themselves and father died when they got this far and she just stayed. Very interesting though that nobody else tries to trifle with her. Not even Warren William, really, right? So there's no sexual advances made upon her by anyone. So she really is.
Well, initially, at least, we are meant to believe she's good with a gun.
Well, she is good with a gun. We see her shoot many people when they're on the...
Mostly Indians.
Yeah.
But yeah, it seems... I mean, there aren't a lot of sexy young men, for one thing, I guess. But also, it's just... He just takes this fancy to her right away, despite the fact that she is not in any way feminine.
Well, yeah, he's impressed by her gumption in getting her money back. These guys stole $1,100 from her.
And the visible age difference actually kind of lends itself to, like, it makes a certain amount of sense that he is impressed by her in this way. Just mean that there's an inherent power difference.
Sure.
In an older woman, younger man relationship that makes sense that the man would find her impressive.
Yeah. Well, she is impressive in those early scenes. And he does defer to her, although he doesn't follow all of her instructions. She says, no serenades. Although it turns out that she's happy that he did.
But anyway, as I was saying, that scene where she makes the turkey, they are careful to emphasize that she shot it herself.
Yeah.
She teases him about, you're supposedly a man, so let's see you go to work on this meal.
Yeah.
And she doesn't, Arthur doesn't make any feminine concessions in the way she's playing the character, despite the fact that she's got a dress on. So even in that scene, I was like, okay, well, there's like an interesting mixture of things going on. Maybe they can continue to play with this, right? Rather than, they don't necessarily have to be two men together.
No.
So maybe they can continue to play with these gender conventions and it'll remain interesting. But unfortunately, that's not ultimately the way that the movie goes. Then we go through this whole period where he's kind of doing her bidding.
Well, again, yeah, she's the boss. She's the one with the vision for the future. He's just a drifter, really. Came in with some settlers from St. Louis. He's not sure what he's doing with his life. And she has a plan.
She'd initially tried to hire him before he left for California.
On this freight line that she's developing. And then later on, she thinks that she can see a spot for him helping to run the ranch. And in fact, she gives him this task, this errand, as she puts it and as he jokes about.
Well, first he has to prove himself.
Why don't you go off to Nebraska for 6 months and get me all these cows?
First he has to prove himself that he's worth something as a man by getting her this army contract.
Right.
So that she can make enough money to buy the ranch and the cattle. Well, she has the land.
Well, she bought up all the land. Again, she's, you know, a very canny entrepreneur. When a lot of people left because the army was leaving, she uses all of the money she's got to expand her holdings so that she now has the place for these cattle to roam.
And he does call her the boss.
Sure he does.
At a certain point in this mix, which again kind of gets an extra frisson for me anyway by the fact that he's a younger, pretty man. So that's starting to play with not just a relationship of equals, but of her having more power in it, and not just sexual power, but economic power and authority. But everything goes downhill from there. It's like the movie can't comprehend how to make a plot out of this, and I guess the book could, so it's not like they don't have a model. A plot out of all of this without putting her in distress, or else gender anxiety just takes hold at a certain point, and who knows whose it is? If they were just anticipating that the audience wouldn't accept this, or what?
The really interesting thing about the end is, like, she's not a damsel in distress. It's really Holden that's in distress because he's the one that has to fight it out.
No, but she's a damsel in distress along the way. She explicitly gets rescued by him. At one point where she's got, what's his face?
Oh, Porter Hall.
Porter Hall at gunpoint.
Yeah, yeah, that's earlier on. And you're right. She shouldn't have gotten bested by Porter Hall. That was, I think, a mistake in the
But even play. That could have gotten played, like, because I think it's sometime after that he says, we need to be a team, or you need some kind of backup, permanent backup, right? Even that could have gotten played like they're forming a team and having a relationship of equals.
Yeah, like Buck and the Preacher.
Yeah.
You know, that one of them by themselves can't do it.
Exactly. But still, this is not the direction it goes in. I was giving it a chance at every turn here.
No, and the final dramatic situation is that on their wedding day, so interesting, it kind of anticipates High Noon in some ways, right? The wedding day, the shootout that's coming.
But even before that, he tells her, like, let's slow down a little bit here before we get to the ending. Even before that, when he leaves, he tells her, don't shoot your mouth off while I'm gone and get yourself into trouble and don't go off half-cocked and, you know, try to take matters into your own hands again. So this voice of masculine authority just appears out of nowhere. It's like the characters turn into different characters. Because we don't see the psychological progression of this at all. Except that, I guess she gets herself into some stupid situations, or...
She does, and he's joined the army in the meantime, right? So that is, a different perspective that he's gained.
Maybe, yeah, maybe. But then she does shoot her mouth off and get him into trouble. But then when they discuss this afterwards, when she meets him and she goes and rides out to him and does help him in this battle against the Indians, but he's the one who comes up with the idea that actually saves them.
Yeah, stampeding the cattle.
Warren Williams' machinations. So again, she's becoming stupider and stupider and less of an agent within the film's plot. Then when she tells him what she's done, we think she's going to get some kind of reprimand, like a child, because she has acted stupidly. Instead of which, he's delighted.
Yeah.
Because now she's corrected everything. We never saw him want this correction toward a patriarchal norm, but now all of a sudden that is what the character wants, even though initially he didn't. They just turn into different characters.
That's definitely a problem.
And then from there on, that is the remainder of the story that plays out.
And Warren William, you know, he's basically eliminating all of his co-conspirators so that nothing can be proved in one of these dubious courts of law that are convened on the street at various points by drunken judges. So even that is not going to avail them anything. It's going to have to be settled on the streets in a gunfight. And that's, again, what makes me think of High Noon. With that conjunction of the fated gunfight and the marriage on the same day.
But we are really waiting to see, I guess because the movie has, within its own terms, thrown his masculinity into question so much by pairing him with her, that we are waiting to see what the outcome of this is. Lots of different things went through my mind. That she would be widowed and blame herself for it, because she got him into this position. That she would join him in the fight. That she would revenge him. Basically, all of them better outcomes than just he proves he's a man.
I agree with you. Although it does give her a pretty great scene.
Sure.
Where she's waiting.
Yeah, but I just don't care.
People are waiting to see if she's going to start crying. Because that's what they're expecting her to do. And again,
that's the only concession the movie makes to her being the same person as she was at the start of it.
Yeah, she's still just as tough. She's just in a wedding dress at this point.
So you can't say of this movie that it can't imagine a relationship between equals where she is not expected to observe gender norms, because it can imagine that. So that makes it like even worse what it does with the ending, because it seems so arbitrary.
There could have been other decisions made here.
I'm not sure though. Could there have been? Do we have other examples of Westerns that play with gender? Because I'm not too familiar with the Barbara Stanwyck ones. Are they? And they're not this early, are they?
Yeah, sure. Annie Oakley is 1935.
Okay. I'm thinking more of her kind of cattle rancher.
Yeah. Those are from the 50s.
Woman roles. But I'm wondering if a movie comes on as strong with these ideas about gender as this one does at the beginning, does it necessarily have to resolve in this way? You know what I mean?
It was much worse in The Plainsman.
Of course. She became stupid the second she put a dress on.
Right.
And incompetent.
So if you're comparing this to that, it's revolutionary.
And did Jean Arthur want this? Did she think this was necessary? Like Katharine Hepburn, because we know she liked playing these androgynous roles. Did she think, like Katharine Hepburn, that it's necessary for her character to be feminized by the end of the movie? Or
doesn't say anything about did she want changes to the Arizona script or not. There's nothing in there about that. But she was very concerned about Hollywood seeing her as a viable, attractive star.
Yeah, but she also wanted to play roles like this.
Yeah, she's conflicted. Very conflicted. I don't think this was a good use of Jean Arthur's time. They spend a lot of money and time on this movie.
And it ends up just being a ball of confusion. And also, like I said, the only dramatic interest in it is supplied by a real misuse of Warren William.
The shifty man, Cataret.
Now, do I really care about the kind of character she plays at the beginning of the movie? No, like I said, this is a thoroughly unpleasant person. The only thing that's interesting about her is that she is engaged in this defiance of gender norms, and that's gone by the end of the movie. You know, it's not necessarily a model of personhood, this masculinized woman that I necessarily care about. But if you're going to do it, then have some consistency.
Stick to your guns. She doesn't. She gives her gun over to William Holden. That's unfortunate.
There's definitely something sexy about their relationship, and it definitely helps this age difference accident early on. And it's just too bad the movie could not have stuck to its radical convictions the way Too Many Husbands does. It's like Ruggles, if he doesn't have to sort of tackle the gender question overtly, can do a lot more with it.
Well, actually, I think that is true of Hollywood in general, at that time especially, right?
Yeah, the only actress who ever really gets away with it is Garbo and Queen Christina, and that was a project that she came up with herself and was adamant about doing in a certain way.
I mean, did she really get away with it? I don't think that movie did brilliant business in America, right? It was another one. Garbo's movies made money overseas.
This is what I'm saying. It's her own special, it was her own special project, and I don't think she really cared if it made money.
Right.
Or anything, yeah.
Yeah, well, we see Katharine Hepburn doing it in the 30s, but it cost her.
In Sylvia Scarlett, yeah.
In several movies, right? All of which wound up making her box office poison.
Right, and the only ones where she successfully gets away with it is where she has to get some kind of comeuppance at the end, like Woman of the Year.
This was, I think, a turning point in Jean Arthur's career, because what's she going to do? She's stuck at Columbia without Capra now, with her enemy, Harry Cohn. And we're going to have to see.
I did think of the Harry Cohn story, watching her take such pleasure in repeatedly threatening to shoot Porter Hall.
Well, what about at the beginning where she gets those guys to whip each other? That's crazy. It seems kind of like a lost year, although I love Too Many Husbands. I really enjoyed it.
And like you say, she maybe never looked better.
Kind of makes up for any of the failings of Arizona, which are legion. Next week on the podcast, it's the Hollywood Studios Year by Year, 20th Century Fox, 1941. We'll be discussing I Wake Up Screaming, which is an amazing film noir, very early film noir, directed by H. Bruce Humberstone, starring Betty Grable and Victor Mature.
Odd.
And Carol Landis. It's so good. Alicia Cook Jr. has never been weirder.
I probably will challenge that, but...
We'll see what you say after watching this. The other film is a movie I've never seen before. It's Confirm or Deny, which is a foreign correspondent film, an anti-Nazi film. It's directed by Archie Mayo, but also uncredited direction from Fritz Lang.
All right.
See you soon.